Welcome students. Now this is day 3 part 2 reading and we were just discussing again the play on the face of it and we were at page number 64 where we actually discussed that you know what kind of friends or what kind of things had made Mr. Lamb's perception so positive and he said that it is due to watching, it is due to listening, it is due to thinking. And you know, in fact, Jerry asks him that you know if Mr. Lamb will not be there in the garden, so like he could come there or not. So Mr. Lamb said that yes, definitely, because it is everybody's garden. But when Jerry comes to know that it might be possible that some other people will be there, so he said that no, I will really mind coming to the garden because he said that other people might be afraid of him. But Mr. Lamb again tries to mold his perception in a very positive tone and he said that Mr. Lamb said that you know it is not very sure that people are just going to run. They might be scared of you or they might not be scared of you and you have to take risks. There should be risk taking factors in the life. Okay, now page number 65. Jerry, no, you would. You might have me and lose all your other friends because nobody wants to stay near me if they can help it. So Daddy said, no. You should avoid telling me to come here because definitely if other people will find out that I am here in the garden, you are going to lose all your friends. Mr. Lamb, I am not rude. Daddy, no, Mr. Lamb, when I go down the street, the kids shout, Lamy Lamb, but they still come into the garden into my house. It's a game. They are afraid of me. Why should they? Because I'm not afraid of them. That's why not. And so Mr. Lamb said, no, I'm used to such kind of behavior. People are just not scared of me. There is no such reason that they should be scared of me. In fact, they even taunt or they even tease me by the name of Lamy Lamb and I'm used to it. It doesn't trouble me anymore and I really like people coming inside. Jerry, did you get your leg blown off in the war? See, again, Jerry is becoming really much more concerned. Mr. Lamb, certainly. Jerry, how climb on a ladder and get the crab apples down there? See, again, you might have heard that, it is very important to keep the good society, to keep the good people, a good amount of people with you because society teaches us number of things. So as in the play, we can easily relate to the fact that Mr. Lamb being really compassionate and concerned, he is very generous, he is very kind-hearted person and due to this, you know, he had really made Derry to change his perception into a positive manner and that's why now see Derry is actually asking, he is becoming really curious to know that how he has got a thin leg and how this, how he is going to climb the ladder and so. Mr. Lamb, oh, there are lots of things I have learned to do and plenty of time for it. Years I take it steady. So he just says that I take it really very slow and steady because, you know, it took me really years to learn number of things and I keep on practicing and I have learned number of things. Jerry, if you fell and broke your neck, you could lie on the grass and die if you were on your own. So Jerry said, if you were on your own, if you would have been alone, definitely when you climb the ladder, it might be possible that you could fall into the ground and you're going to break your neck and you might die. So when he says that you will fall on your, if you will on your own, it simply means that of course, Mr. Lamb is also lonely. Despite he's trying to change the perception of Jerry, still he is very much lonely. But he had made, he had accepted the way, he had accepted the world. Maybe it is an age factor, maybe it is an optimistic approach, maybe it is the compassionate, kind-hearted or generous or open-minded nature of Lamb. But still, he is lonely from inside. But he is not sharing with the lad. You know, he is okay with everything. Okay. Mr. Lamb, I could die. Jerry, you said I could help you. Mr. Lamb, if you want to. See, now Jerry. When Mr. Lamb for the very first time, he tried to befriend with Derry, Derry did not say anything. In fact, he said that when I go there, I won't come here again and we will not be friends forever. But now, Derry said that, okay, you were asking me to help you. So, if you don't mind, I can come here. So, Mr. Lamb said, okay, fine. It's your wish. If you want to come, it's fine. Derry, but my mother will want to know where I am. It's 3 miles home across the fields. I'm 14, but they still want to know where I am. So daddy said that, see, I'm 14 years old and my mother is 3 miles across. My house is at a distant place, but you know, I'm 14 years old, but still everyone wants to know about me. My mother is very concerned about me. She really wants to know every time that where I am and with whom I'm living. And so, Mr. Lam, people worry. So Mr. Lam says, people worry. But daddy says, people fuss. So what do you mean by fuss? First of all, fuss means just to pay attention to something which is really unimportant. So again, there is a change of perception. Lamp is saying people worry, whereas Derry is saying people fuss. So it is not like that. Of course, his mother will show concern because Derry is what? Derry is her child. So definitely, it is a role and responsibility of a parent to know about whereabouts about the child. So it's very important to know about it. So what? So when he's saying that people fuss, it simply means that, you know, he's just getting very irritated about the concept that why his mother keeps on asking about him again and again. But Mr. Lam says people worry. Mr. Lam, go back and tell them, Derry, it's 3 miles. Mr. Lam, it's a fine evening, you have got legs. Derry, once I got home, they would never let me come back. Mr. Lam, once I got home, you would never let yourself come back. Derry, you don't know what I could do. Mr. Lam, no, only you know that. Derry, if I chose. Mr. Lam, if you chose, I don't know everything. Boy, I can't tell you what to do. So Derry said that, yes, then I will be at my place. They will not allow to come back again. But Mr. Lam said that, no, it's all up to you what you want to do. And if you think that you can know everything about yourself, so I'm not the one who... And I won't be forcing you, you know, to take any sort of obligation from you. If you want to come, that's your choice. If you don't want to come, even that's your choice. Derry, they tell me, Mr. Lam, do you have to agree? So Derry said that, no, they always ask me to stay here. They always ask me not to go somewhere. So Mr. Lam said that, do you agree like every time? Derry, I don't know what I want. I want something no one else has got or ever will have. Something just mine, like this garden. I don't know what it is. So see, Derry is very confused from the, he's very perplexed. Right from the starting, he's very much judgmental. He's very much, full of complexes right from the very beginning of this play. He says that, I really don't want anything. I really don't know what I want. Sometimes I want a garden. Sometimes I want a house, I like. But I really don't know what my real quest is. Mr. Lam, you could find out. So Mr. Lam said, no. You are the one. You have to find it out. And you have the capability to actually find your true aim. Derry, how? Mr. Lam, waiting, watching, listening. So Mr. Lam said, yes, you can. It depends on you that how you want to find out what is your real aim in life, by watching, by stopping, by listening, something like this. Sitting here or going there, I will have to see to the breeze. And Mr. Lam again changes the topic, you know. He just, they actually hear the writer is the, taking the readers from the boredom to the other side of the play. And again, Mr. Lam is just, you know, through the words of Mr. Lam, writer wants to say and writer wants to, you know, mold the direction of the play. So that's why Mr. Lam says, no, I really have to see the bees. I really have to take care of the bees as they might be waiting for me. Okay. Derry, those are the people who come here. Do they talk to you, ask you things? So Derry said that all of the people who come here, do they talk to you, do they ask you things, Mr. Lam? Some do, some don't. I ask them, I like to learn. And Mr. Lam said that, yes, it depends on some people. Some people ask me things, some people say, but sometimes I ask, sometimes nobody asks. Derry, I don't believe in them. I don't think anybody ever comes. You are here all by yourself and miserable, and no one would know if you were alive or dead and nobody cares. So see, Derry is actually trying to give a jolt to Mr. Lam that, oh, you have to shaken yourself. You know, it's a reality. You know, you expect a fairy world, but it is not like that. I feel that nobody comes here. You don't have any friend and nobody cares about you. You are all alone. You are all lonely in your life. And, you know, it will not matter to somebody if you will even die someday. Mr. Lam, you think what you please. So Mr. Lam said, okay, it's fine. If you think like this, that's your choice. Derry, all right then, tell me some of their names. So Derry said, okay, fine. If you think that you have number of friends, so tell me what are their names. Mr. Lam, what are names? Names, you know, what is there in the name? So he said, Storm, Dick or Harry, getting up. I'm off down to the bees. Maybe here, you know, Mr. Lam is also very startled, you know. He also knows the reality because he's all alone and he is talking to Derry because he wants to have a human interaction, he wants to have a human bond with someone, and all of a sudden, you know, he wants to change the topic and he says that, no, I'm really getting late to the bees, I really have to take care of them. Terry, I think you are a deft crazy. So he said, I think you are a mad person, you are a crazy person. Mr. Lam, that's a good excuse. So Mr. Lam said, that's a very good excuse. You don't want to come here again to help me and you are now giving me excuse. Terry, what for? You don't talk sense. So Terry said that, no, I don't have anything to, give you, any sort of excuse. I know you, because you always talk nonsense. There is no such base whatever you are saying right now. Mr. Lam, good excuse not to come back, and you have got a burnt up face, and that's all other people's excuse. And Mr. Lam says, yes, I know you are good, just giving me an excuse, because you cannot agree, you cannot talk to your mother or talk to your parents that you should be here to help me, and that's why you are giving me an excuse every time. Terry, you are like the others, you like to say things like that. If you don't feel sorry for my face, you are frightened of it, and if you are not frightened, you think I'm ugly as a devil. I'm a devil, don't you? He shouts. Now Terry is really getting very aggressive, very irritated, and he says that, I know even you are scared of me. You are scared of my face, and if you are not frightened, you are not scared, it means that I am a monster, and I believe that I am a monster. See, he is talking to himself, and Mr. Lam is really not interested in what he is saying right now. Terry, quietly, no you don't, I like it here. He paused, Terry gets up and shouts, I am going but I will come back, you see, you wait, I can run, I have not got a chill lag, I will be back. So see, now Terry is trying to taunt him that I will come back, I know I am almost dependent on myself and definitely I will be there, whatever you think about me, it's okay, I have not got a chill lag. It means that he really wants to come here, wants to help Mr. Lam, and see how this kind of perception has been changed by Mr. Lam, and that's why I told you that Mr. Lam's story and Mr. Lam character is actually a parable. It is actually giving us a moral lesson to think positively, to just make things to feel all right every time, even if we are facing some tough and hard times, because happiness that lies from inside, that lies in our perception. Now again, what the scene is just standing now, this is the conclusion of scene one. It is a garden of Mr. Lam. Now the time, it is a time where the plot has been moved, and it is just going to move from the Mr. Lam's garden actually, because Terry is just leaving the garden, and just Mr. Lam has just got up from the bench and he had just gone to the hive just to take care of the bees. So he just now, Mr. Lam, please pay attention here. Mr. Lam, now he's talking to himself. Why to himself? Because he's all alone. Actually, he's very all alone, but he's not posing it. He's just not, pretending it to be. So to himself, there are my dears that you seem to. We all know I will come back. They never do though. Not them. Never do come back. The garden mice is fate. So he's talking to himself that, all my dears, he's talking to the bees, all this property owned, all these aspects and other little species that have been made by nature, they are all his friends, and he's talking to the bees that, I will come back to you, but I know whosoever comes in the garden, they just make false promises. They always say that we'll come back, but never do. And who is there? He knows the reality that maybe Derry will not even come back. It shows that Mr. Lam is actually what? He's very much lonely, and he expected a human interaction and human bond with Terry. Despite of his physical impairments, he changes his perception. He changes his outlook of the life. But he knows the reality that maybe Terry is not even going to come back. But now in the next lecture, in the next video, I'm going to tell you the conclusion of this particular play, that what happens in scene 2 and scene 3, and we'll also come to know about it, that what is the ultimate bond that is going to unite them, both of them, because they are different personalities, but there will be something between them that is just going to make them one. Thank you.